department, which was, you know, really cool. And just to be hands-on and in on everything was awesome, even though a lot of the things at the time I was doing were still very much intern responsibilities. So I was able to continue taking classes in Manhattanville, took some summer classes. The internship ended in the fall of 2009. And then I was still in class and then back at the golf course, looking for opportunities, getting my golf game back in shape, and actually started playing in some tournaments, made some connections at the Met Golf Association, which ran some of the tournaments that I was qualifying for. And that eventually turned into an internship opportunity at the Met Golf Association in 2010 that at the end of that year turned into a full-time gig as their foundation programs manager. The thing with the Met Golf Association, it's so small, you do a little bit of everything. So my main responsibilities were in their charitable foundation, but I was writing for their magazine. I was running tournaments, running charity events, trying to get my hands in on everything and just get as much experience as I could. And, you know, it was good because everybody worked hard, and eventually, you know, 4 or 5 years, I didn't see myself going anywhere. So I had stayed in touch with my boss at the NHL. We'd play golf once a year. I'd sort of just ask him if there are any opportunities. And he said, when there is an opportunity, I'll let you know. And the end of 2014, there was an opportunity, and I took it, and I've been there for almost 6 years now. And same boss, same department. Department's bigger now than it was when I was there 10 years ago interning. And it's bigger than it was 6 years ago when I started. And the job has taken me all over the world. It's doing PR and communications for all of our events. So that's outdoor games, All-Star, Stanley Cup playoffs, awards draft. We've been to China 2 times, Europe the last 3 years, multiple times. So, you know, I write a lot of press releases. I moderate almost all the press conferences that you'll see on TV, from Stanley Cup finals and conference finals. And it's just been really cool being around best athletes in the world, best league in the world. And I don't know.
No, it's great. I appreciate that. Great input, and obviously a great career as well. So back to Kristin. Kristin, you mentioned sponsorship before, about taking a sponsorship class. You know, the program is a 36-credit program. It includes, obviously, an internship piece, but there are some courses that you can take, and obviously some that are required. You know, what courses or course? I want to ask you about professors, because that, you know, we don't want to get too political with that. But what really kind of resonated with you as you were going through it? Like, this is, you know, a really important, I think it's going to be good for me in my career, that type of thing.
Well, it's funny you say don't call out professors, because I actually don't remember the name of the class, but I remember the professor. I want to say it was like Terrence Jackson. And we had to do a bunch of case studies and really like dive into our perspective of how we'd handle a situation. And I remember like it was also as I was ending the program. So I was definitely, you know, more versed in the just in sports entertainment in general. So, you know, as I progressed through the courses of, you know, what was required, and then you get to kind of choose a few that are tailored to you. You know, you start, when you're going for your master's, you know, you're serious about your career. You're serious about really kind of getting to that next level and learning the path that you want to go. So I definitely just, you know, took everything more seriously than I ever did with my undergrad, for sure. And you start tying it back to your work, or you start tying it back to things that you've read, and, you know, you try and develop those skills so that when you are put into that situation, you know, you can kind of always think back. And I always think back to that professor, because, you know, he saw something in me that really you know, saw this passion for kind of diving into a case study. I think it actually had to do more so with like culture on a team, and how to build your team and make sure that everybody is growing within there. And he kind of saw that, which I still tie now to how I manage people, how I try to keep the culture great on the team. You know, it's a stressful job and everyone can get run down. And I just remember being like, keep seeing the big picture and make sure that everybody, is following you along with that. So, and I wish I could remember, I was trying to go through my email to see if I could actually find the class itself. So if I do, I'll let you know.
Well, it might've been strategic negotiations. I mean, it could have been that, or it might've been the sports law, but Terrence, I think you know what? I forgot about Terrence. That's actually very interesting. You bring him up.
Yeah. So,
good one. Jeff, how about you?
I would say, Barry Wilner's, sports writing and PR class, I believe. That was definitely a smaller class size, and Barry gave some really cool assignments. Sometimes you made your own assignment, like, or picked your own topics, or sometimes he chose the topics, but it was, you know, writing heavy, but made you think outside the box on a lot of things. And, you know, this is more specific to my career path, but, you know, I did do a lot of writing, tried to be as creative as I could. And, you know, Barry always offered really good feedback on whether something was great or how it could be better. And, you know, I think that went a long way, especially, you know, when I started working at the Met Golf Association, like sort of volunteering to start writing some feature articles in their magazine when I really didn't have much writing experience prior to that. And, you know, I did articles on Martin Brodeur, Eli Manning, John Stark. So even though I was working in golf, I was keeping everything kind of sports related, Jim Nance. You know, and I had published pieces in a magazine, which I never would have thought. And, you know, just having good writing skills, you know, translated to really my next gig, because now I'm writing press releases, memos to, you know, either C-level executives or media across the continent or the world, describing what's going on at the NHL. And you obviously need to be sharp, not make too many mistakes on those.
You gotta be buttoned up. You know, I'm glad you brought that up, and I'm glad you mentioned Barry for a reason. You know, so one of the things, and there's a diversification of people on this call, so on the Zoom call, you know, one of the things that we've stressed the program from the beginning, and part of it is my background too, and where I came from as a former, you know, person who worked in college athletics and sports information and public relations like that. But not just for that, those areas, you know, we're out a lot. We talk to a lot of people in the industry, and almost over the years, we've heard this over and over again, please send us people who can write, you know, and writing is a really important skill. And it's getting lost a little bit, I think, with the younger group. I mean, I have a son who's 21, who's a college graduate, and it's important that he knows and that people know that, you know, yeah, we know that you can use 40 characters to get your point across nowadays. But at the end of the day, you know, it's a well-written letter, it's a well-written memo, it's a well-written press release that's going to get you noticed. It's the one, and also the ones that'll get you noticed are the ones that aren't well-written. So I think writing is very important. Element, and Barry is the perfect guy for that. And by the way, he's teaching a sports communications class in the fall, because Barry has written, I think he's written more books than I've read. He's written like 50 something books and in sports related areas. And you can Google Barry Wilner and it'll come right up, because he's the top AP writer for the NFL. In fact, when at the Super Bowl, when they do the post-game press conference, everybody knows, out of respect, Barry gets the first question. So that's the type of person we're dealing with there. And across the board, our adjuncts are tremendous. And I kind of have to say that because there's a couple of them on here, but no, they really are. So, Kristin, how about you? Do you see writing as something important in your job skills as well? Chris?
What'd you say?
Do you see writing as an important element?
It's so important. And I think this is not just in marketing. I think it translates to a lot of different businesses, but, you know, storytelling is huge. no matter what you're doing. You know, in my world, it's important because we're trying to sell through these ideas, you know, especially to companies who don't know what professional wrestling is. They don't know who our superstars are. So you really have to take a deep dive in, like, really explaining to them why this particular superstar would be a good fit for your brand. And writing is so important, even as simple as just communicating internally. You know, if you have to manage up, and your senior execs, you know, they don't have a lot of time to just kind of read through all these thoughts or read through. You have to get to your point, and you have to get to it quickly, and effectively and efficiently. And it's just, it's a huge part of just every aspect of what I do day to day.
It's pretty important, right? So,
yeah.
Thank you for that. Let's talk specifically about WWE. And actually, I think we have a lot of alumni at WWE working there, and you know, the first guy who came to me, I think, was Justin Martorano, I'm pretty sure, he actually, that was his goal, you know, when he came into the program, was to work for WWE. And I remember sitting at my desk, and I just kind of looked at him, and I just said, you know, it's not real, right? It's not super. He's like, yeah, no, but you know, that group, I mean, they know how to market. They're marketing geniuses, right?
Yes, they are.
So listen, and I know people who've gotten, you know, who came from WWE and gone into other areas of the sports industry. So you're not pigeonholed at all, I don't believe. So
no, not at all. Not at all.
So tell us a little bit about WWE specifically and how they're dealing with this pandemic and what, you know, what their goals are going forward, maybe for the, you know, next few months. Just in general, you don't have to get
sure. You know, I think like most companies, we definitely saw a hit. One of our biggest revenue drivers are live events. So with that off the table, you know, we've definitely taken a hit, and they've had to furlough a substantial amount of employees. But the good news is they are, you know, slowly bringing those folks back. So it's every intention to kind of, you know, get back to that level that we were at. But again, with the, you know, live events, we go back and forth. It sounds like the goal is to be back in front of a limited audience by the end of August, but that changes, you know, with the news daily. We've been able to maintain our Raw and SmackDown television shows weekly, sometimes taped, sometimes live, but we've only been able to do that because we own a facility down in Florida where it's very controlled. We can, you know, follow all the proper guidelines to make sure that, you know, we're keeping everybody safe while we're down there. So we've been very fortunate enough to be able to keep our television shows running. And then as I was just telling you, from a sponsorship perspective, a huge part of, you know, the revenue that we bring in has to do with being able to create custom content with our superstars. So a lot of that, you know, we've gotten creative where we've done a lot of selfie videos and talent can kind of manage themselves. But when you get into these larger productions, you know, that's a big part of our partnerships, and we haven't had that access or been able to travel. So that is starting to be lifted a little bit. I was just at a production for a couple days. I will be quarantining for the next 2 weeks. But it was just nice to be able to kind of get back out there, because the quicker we can get back to that normalcy, the quicker we can get, you know, back up to the level that we were yeah. running.
Well, let's all hope that happens soon. Yep. Jeff, obviously you're, you know, the NHL is very public in terms of what's happening. So why don't you fill us in a little bit, just for those who might not know what the plan is and your role in that as well.
So on Monday, phase three of our restart plan will commence. And phase three means all players will report to their home cities. They've already been approved that they would like to go to their home cities to work out in a limited basis, but this will be more like their regular workouts and practices with coaches involved. And then on August 1st is when phase four is set to begin. And teams will be traveling to two hub cities, which haven't been announced yet, but the news is saying Edmonton and Toronto. But it was saying Vegas and Vancouver just a week ago. But you'll have 12 teams in each city. They'll play a qualifying tournament to determine the 8 playoff teams in each conference. And then it will be Stanley Cup playoffs as usual in these two hub cities, which are, will be protected in a bubble. And there is literature out there. I think there's 47 pages that have all the parameters of phase three and phase four. Some writers have summed it up very nicely. If you want to take a look at that, but it's really, it seems buttoned down right now, but you never know. Really unbelievable is that the labor negotiations have commenced during this time. And even though the players still need to vote, it sounds like we'll have labor peace for a period of time here, which the last three negotiations resulted in lockouts, sometimes even stoppages that affected the length of the season. So that's really good news on our front. And, hats off to, my boss, Gary Bettman, and the PA for working through this at this time, because it could not have been easy.
Yeah, you know what? That's a really interesting point, because baseball, and rightly so, got hammered for how they kind of handled their negotiations through this time. It's going to happen again next year with baseball because of their collective bargaining agreement is due. And then it's coming down the road also for football. We're starting to see where football is going to start to have some problems. So, these are the types of things that I think, especially in our sports law class, strategic negotiations, we had a role of an agent class last semester, Lee Steinberg, who's Pat Mahomes' agent. Lee's come on several times with us to talk about, all the players he represents. For those of you who don't know Lee Steinberg, he was Jerry Maguire was the cat was who he was supposed to be. I was based off of Lee Steinberg, and Lee has a ton of great professional NFL players. So, but it's going to be very interesting. I'm a big hockey fan, Jeff. And at the end of the day, when people come into the program, we try to tell them, it's not about being a fan. It's about the business side. So, check your fandom at the door. With all that said, I'm looking forward to the Islanders winning another cup. So, and I know how you feel about that, Jeff, so you don't have to say anything.
It's a level playing field. It's going to be very, very entertaining. Once August 1st comes, there's going to be six games a day to start off.
It's almost like a World Cup of high, or kind of Olympics, if you will, type thing format, right?
Yeah, it'll be closer to a 3-month tournament, though.
Yeah. All right. Chris, back to you. Next question from me, at least, and if anybody has any questions, for those of you who got dropped or whatever, their bios are on this chat. I'm happy to send anybody bios, the video that we have of this, which the second time I did forget Laura, so I started it late, but at the end of the day, it's okay. So, Kristin, recommendations for young people looking to get into our industry. If somebody were to come to you and whether it's a friend or just say, how do I get to where you are? What do you recommend? What would you say to that, Chris?
I mean, I can tell you, and I'm sure, Jeff would agree that, it's demanding. It's very, it's demanding, and it's a job that a lot of people want. So, really finding a way to get your foot in the door and building relationships, and authentic relationships, not just trying to keep in touch with someone to say, hey, can you help me get a job? Like really taking the time to have conversations, learn about what they do, and just really show an interest that way. And finding a way to get your foot in the door, I think will help you, tremendously. WWE is a great example, not just my story, but there's a lot of people who, once they get their foot in the door, they end up jumping into another department within WWE. They are fine moving people kind of around so that you find what you're passionate about, but still kind of under that same family. So, I mean, networking, you always hear it everywhere you go, like networking is important, but I mean, it really is. And doing it the right way is also very important, because a lot of people can kind of see through that genuine interest and the, hey, can you just help me out here? So taking advantage of all the opportunities that you have is important, whether you believe it or not.
good answer. Jeff, how do you feel about that?
Yeah, I mean, network as much as you can. I'm a big fan of informational interviews. I'm always willing to get on the phone with somebody. And, you know, I remember going down to the city, you know, probably half a dozen times one summer just to meet with people and ask them about what they do and, you know, how can I get my foot in the door? And, you know, that could lead to something, but it's just good to sort of expand your network. In my mind, it's good to get face-to-face contact, which is hard now, but, you know, grab a cup of coffee with somebody or grab a beer or a bite and, you know, ask them about their career paths and, you know, how you might be able to get started.
Thank you, Jeff. There are a couple of questions here in the chat, which, Brian, I'll take these just so you know. Desiree, thank you for your question. Do you need to be a fan of a team or is sport to work with that company? I'm not sure. I mean, it's probably the NHL situation. Can the experience and knowledge be enough to apply to be considered for the position? Can the experience and knowledge be? So let me just start with the first part. Tell you a story. David Newman, who was the former vice president of marketing for the New York Mets, told us a story, and thank God it wasn't one of our students. The story he told was simple. You know, in our world, Jeff and Kristin and Gene Doris and other people on this call, you know, your cover letter is intended to get your resume read. Your resume is, the intention of the resume is to get you face to face with somebody, get you that interview, get you, and it tells your story, right? But if those two things did their jobs, then it's on you, because you're going to be going in face to face for an interview, hopefully. When you get that opportunity, obviously you want to put your best foot forward. Some young man got the interview, so those things did their jobs for him. But when he walked in, he was well-dressed, but he was also wearing a Met hat. And David stopped him at the door and said, thank you, you know, I appreciate the fact that you're a fan of the team. The ticket office is down the hall, but we're not going to go through with the interview today because this is not what I need. I need somebody who's going to help me with my business. I don't care that you're a fan of the team. So point being, we all have teams we root for. I just, you know, told you about the Islanders, but at the end of the day, I don't want a job with the Islanders, right? So you have to be a little bit smart. And I'm sure the kid thought he was being, listen, this guy's going to think I'm really into it. Not what they need. Okay. So that, hopefully that answers the first part of the question. The second part, I'm going to let somebody else answer, cause I'm not really sure what you mean, but there's another question here. And this is for Jeff and Kristin. Jeff, we'll start with you this time. What was your most rewarding experience at Manhattanville? If you could have focused on something while attending, what would it have been? I'm not sure if they mean classes or, but why don't you give that a shot? Most rewarding experience, other than meeting Nick and myself and, you know.
Well, I think that when I enrolled in that first semester and didn't have, you know, the internship for the NHL, I was working at the golf course, which was closed in the winter. Getting that internship was huge. And, you know, I remember the interview, them asking about my classes. And I just remember being so excited to be enrolled in, it was basically the 100 level classes, the basic ones at the time. But they took an interest in that. And, you know, I really liked the elective that I was taken to with Barry, and I think it just made me feel like I was heading in the right direction by enrolling in Manhattanville. Like, yeah, this is what I want to do, and you know, this potentially could lead to some good things and to where I want to be.
Okay, Chris, we're getting some good questions here, so I'm going to ask you another one, Kristin. In the current environment, obviously, we all know what Deanna is referring to here. And thank you, Deanna, for the question. in this current environment and all the effects that it's had on the sports industry, is there anything that's going to make a candidate stand out specifically? Like maybe something they've done, maybe they've started a master's program that will, you know, tell people, hey, you didn't just sit around waiting for the world to come back to normal. What is it for you, Chris?
I'm sorry, you cut out a little bit.
Okay, yeah. So the question is, in this current environment, is there something specific that a candidate can do to make themselves stand out? Is it maybe?
Yeah, I mean, we're even doing it. It's about, you know, staying active when it could be very easy to take a break. You know, we, especially when this first hit, you know, the workload, a lot of companies on my side paused media. They paused promoting anything because they just kind of, they thought it was poor taste to be advertising knowing people are home. And you know, they just wanted to be gracious there. So, you know, when we had a little bit of that downtime, you weren't just kind of sitting around waiting. We were doing online learning, and still kind of staying active on LinkedIn and keeping in touch with our partners. Just kind of showing that, you know, through like what Dave just said, through all of this, that you were still focused on your career, still focused on progressing and keeping those conversations alive. I mean, it's the same thing with the employees that have been furloughed. Like, you can tell some folks who are still, you know, they just want to come back. So they're keeping in touch with the right people. And it's very important to make sure people know that you're staying active.
Thank you. So Kristin, we're going to stay with you and I'll ask you both this question because I think it's a good question. It comes from Maddie. Do you think your Manhattanville network and alumni status helped you to get to where you are, or have you seen it help others applying now? I guess is it, yeah, so.
Yeah, 1,000%. Like I said, I mean, I got my foot in the door because of people I met in the program. And Dave touched on it earlier, but there's a lot of employees who landed at WWE who went through the program. And I can say, Dave, I feel like we have kept in contact since I graduated. You know, Dave's very good at trying to bring back alumni to share their experiences, even incorporate companies into career fairs to help give the students a better opportunity to have the right conversations right from the start. So I would 1,000% say that the network has helped me get where I am today.
Love your answer, Kristin. Thank you.
Yeah. I didn't rehearse it either. I didn't rehearse it.
No endorsement fees paid here. Yeah. Jeff, how about you?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I remember using all of my professors as resources when I was at Manhattanville because I was looking for other jobs also. And it's one of those things, you're not going to be hand-fed that stuff, but everybody is available and, you know, willing to help you out. And then, you know, I tried to pay it forward as much as I could. I know we got the Met Golf Association to your career fair. We couldn't get the NHL there, but
they've been there before though. They have been.
But yeah, for sure. And I know Dave's always reaching out to me or keeping me updated. And I know that there's a network there that I can, you know, shoot a note to or a text to if I need anything.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we're this is going to sound really corny, and it is corny. We're a family. Like I said, several hundred graduates, many working in the sports industry. Not all. I'll be honest. There are people who are working in general business, and that's great. I mean, at the end of the day, sports really is not for everyone. It is demanding. It is, in some cases, not well paid. Those, you know, you gotta, you know, sounds trite, but, you know, people paying their dues and working their way up. I mean, I did it for many years in college athletics for the National Football Foundation. And to this day, and networking is very important to me, not just networking with these great students, our alumni, our adjuncts, guest speakers. The more people we bring into the fold, the better it is, not just for me, but for, you know, our constituents, which are our students and our alumni. So thank you both for those kind words. I do appreciate it. At the end of the day, you know, and I appreciate your time. You are paying it forward by joining us today, and I do appreciate it. We're going to keep this we're not going to go much longer because I think people do have things that they're doing still, even though it's, you know, kind of a weird time and we're all in different places. But how about this for a question? What would you recommend, like, as a program? Like, what would you like to see if we were to grow? Because we've always added, like, different courses and things like that. Jeff, is there something you would like to see in the program differently, or maybe a different type of class?
I think anything that keeps it sort of hands-on and less about the textbook. I think there's a couple classes that you sort of have to go by the book, but and a lot of this is on the student too. I mean, just be as creative as you can out there with some of the assignments. Reach out to as many people as possible, because a lot of it was on the student to make sure that they're engaged in a lot of the things that you set up, Dave, or networking events, some of those guest speakers. You know, it's almost like you need to be responsible for making sure you take that extra step, and if you're serious about, you know, a job in this industry.
Thank you. Chris, how about you? Any thoughts? Any progressive?
Yeah. I have two thoughts. One, back to, I found out the name of that class I was talking about was Leading Change.
Ah.
So I don't know if you still have that, but it was a great course.
Okay.
And then secondly, you know, it's more so about, I don't know if it's a specific, you know, class that you should have, but just something like an observation that I've made throughout my career, presenting to people and being able to kind of be quick on your feet with responses is just, I think, a skill that would help anyone in their career, just having that comfort. I wasn't always comfortable. I still have much room to grow in that area, but I remember, like, public speaking, avoiding it in my undergrad, and I, you know, even throughout grad school, we did a lot of group presentations, which helped. But maybe, you know, making sure that is a skill, no matter what class it is, that's kind of being, you know, hammered home into your students, because it's just important. If you can kind of get over that hurdle and get comfortable, you know, it'll take you far.
Great input. Thank you very much. Does anybody, I think I got through most of the chat questions here. If not, I apologize. Wait, there's one question specifically for Kristin here. Let me get this. The WWE has changed a lot with changing the name of the Divas division in 2016 to Superstars. Has there been a change in women's involvement behind the scenes of WWE and in their payment? Do you personally feel equal to your male counterparts? So, little different twist here, but why don't you take that?
Yeah, I mean, when I first started at WWE, I was very fortunate because the leadership of my particular department was actually led by a lot of women, which wasn't always rare, but they definitely, you know, looked to place women in those leadership roles. And truthfully, with Stephanie McMahon growing on the executive side like she has, you know, I think some of the rumors or stigmas that are out there about the company are no longer true, which is great. They started a women's affinity group. I want to say that towards the end of last year, which has proven to be pretty successful, just kind of having that platform to support one another. And I can say, you know, with certainty, I do feel equal to my male counterparts. Which is, you know, again, helps by being led by strong women. But, you know, the culture there has actually been really great.
You know, that's really, and thank you for that answer. Thank you for the question, too. You know,
good question.
We were actually going to run another Women in Sports panel on March, I think it was 19th or something, like a week, you know, it's just, we had to cancel, obviously. We'll try to get that going. And we had some really, Ann Liguori. We had the vice president of NBC Sports. I can't think of the name. I'm sorry. But we'll try to do that again. I think we've done that in the past, and I think it's great. Great question. Gene, you have a question for both. Why don't you just chime in here, please?
Sure. This is actually segueing, Kristin, off of what you just said, because I do incorporate in my class where one of the individual projects that they have to do is to get up in front of the class and actually present themselves. And nobody's really very comfortable with that. But looking at, again, and I know we don't like the term new normal all that much, but for both Kristin and Jeff, how much should educators look going forward as to incorporating Zoom and the ability to work through Zoom as part of a group or a leader of a group, Zoom and doing individual presentations? How much of that should be part of classroom structure now going forward as you look at your futures and how much you've had to kind of switch over to all of this in the jobs that you're in?
Do you want to go first, Jeff?
Sure. I mean, it's now, it is the new normal. And I think that if you can get people to participate in a video conference, it could be really beneficial. I mean, I don't know how big the class sizes would have to be, but I know that almost all of us would take ourselves serious enough that we would be on our feet and ready to participate. And I think it could go a long way because it is easy to sit back in a chair and not do anything for the length of the class, depending on how big the class size is. So if you need to be on your feet and know you're going to be called upon, it could go a long way on helping you present yourself and a little bit easier than talking in front of 30 people or more.
Well, I think having the FaceTime is still very important. Everybody has so much going on, running around. So like working from home has been great because I actually feel like a little more balanced where I could, you know, maybe get something personal done, but then, you know, as long as you're responsible, be back in front of your computer when it's time for a meeting. So I hope that this has kind of opened people's eyes to, you know, this new normal. Like, you can still do good and efficient work without being there in person, but I still do think that the FaceTime and being able to converse with other folks and see their face goes a long way. So I still think that there's a balance, but I, you know, whether you have to show up in a classroom or whether you have to log in and be on a meeting, you're still accountable to make sure that you're there. So I think, you know, I do think that you can incorporate that into, you know, your plan moving forward and you would still see a really good outcome from students.
Thanks. Thank you. And thanks, Gene, for the question. Gene Doris, by the way, is teaching in the fall, leading support organizations. He's taught that for many years and we're happy to have him as part of our group. So I'm going to start to wrap this up only out of respect for people's time. I think we have covered quite a bit here. Let me just pump in here Brian Sunday for a second, see if Brian has something he'd like to share with us.
Hi, Dave. Thank you so much. Kristin and Jeff, I just want to personally thank both of you for being here today. Just to give you an idea of the scope of how many different Manhattanville community members we discussed and aligned with today. We have graduates of the sports business program. We have current Manhattanville students. We have professors within the program. We have students, future potential students who have an interest in the program from other colleges. So it's just an amazing, diverse audience. And you all being here is touching so many parts of our community. So I wanted to thank you for that. Really job well done. And just want to do a quick basic housekeeping. Throughout the event, for those that are interested in pursuing Dave's program, the Master of Sport Business and Entertainment Management, I've been dropping in the chat a free application fee waiver to get started, as well as my Manhattanville email so we can connect and get you going because it is the time to take the next steps. And the last thing I'll say is Jeff, you know, you're the second person that I've heard who's had a career start on the golf course. So if there's one thing I could suggest to everybody in the room today, it's take up the game of golf because I did, and I'm sure it set me back a mile. So last but not least, special thanks to Dave. I'm a sports nut. I'm a sports fanatic. I'm also a basketball coach here at the Manhattanville community. And I just, for those that want to pursue a career in sport business, Dave just takes such pride in what he does. I know this is the right program for everyone that's here today. So please touch base with me. And Dave, thank you.
Ryan, thank you, and thanks for those kind words. Jeff, what's the handicap at these days, by the way?
It keeps going up. It's a 7.3 right now. So that's what happens when you start work, when you get married and start working, your handicap goes up.
I don't know. That still sounds pretty good.
I was going to say, I shoot par every time out. When I get to that par, then I just stop playing. Usually by the
third. I had free lessons at PGA, and I just couldn't. My softball swing won't change. Won't change.
And you were a heck of a softball player, Kristin. So
thanks, Dave.
So, guys, thanks again. Jeff, Kristin, everybody who joined the call, thank you for the great questions. Thanks to Brian, and thanks to Laura Persky for joining us. We're going to sign off. And thanks, everybody, for coming back on. You did a great job. And I'll find out who it was who did that to us, and I will personally take care of it.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Take care.
Hello.
Good afternoon, Manhattanville College Office of Admission. This is Brian.
Dave, it's still recording. That was great.
I'm going to stop recording.